Okay, we pick up chapter one, part B, where I'm gonna kind of cover the last stuff. This should be a very short video. And one of the important things, hang on, I have the monitor above my laptop and I wanna go down, but my brain recognizes that it's to the left that I've gotta go to get on the laptop. Anyway, okay, so the proto board or the prototyping board. There we go. We use a lot. Some of the boards have a break between the left and right side. Some are continuous. It just depends who manufactured it. The top two rows are used for power. You could put a plus minus here or plus 12, plus 5, however you want to do it. Here you could put both grounds, or you can have ground down here, or plus 5 and ground, however you want to connect it. It's up to you. Remember, the center section is a big wide gap. Nothing goes there, okay? So as a result, anything connected here, like the pin of an IC versus the pin of another IC, these two are totally separate. Likewise, if we look to the column to the left or the right, the connections go down the column. They do not go across, nor do they go above. So more of a thing you need to be familiar with if you ever have to do any prototyping work. Okay. Review capacitors. Capacitors, I think of it as a bucket for electrons. We apply a voltage, it holds the voltage until it's, you know, and then we discharge it. Capacitors are rated in farads. Now, back in the day, way back when, a long time ago, when I went to college, the instructor used to remind us there's no such thing as a 1 farad capacitor. That would be an enormous capacitor. Nowadays, we have capacitors that go into the hundreds, if not thousands, of farads. They're called supercapacitors. They're really quite handy because they hold so many electrons. Electrolytic capacitors, and let's see what page are we on, page 9, chapter 1, are direction sensitive. Okay, so whenever you work with electrolytic, look closely at it. It will be marked which direction it is. That and tantalum. Tantalum capacitors are direction sensitive. I know it doesn't say here in the text, but it is direction sensitive. On the other hand, not every capacitor is direction sensitive. Ceramic capacitors are not direction sensitive. Okay, so that we want to keep in mind. Now, regarding power, power comes in two forms. Direct current, meaning it's constant, it never changes. Alternating current, which means it goes one way, and then the split second later, it goes the reverse direction back. Battery is always DC. There's no such thing as an AC battery. However, the wall socket, for good reason, had to be AC. Here in the US, it is 60 hertz or 60 times per second. The current flows one way, reverses direction, and then returns to the same path. In Europe and some parts of Asia, it's more like 50 cycles. Why 50? Well, that's what they picked. There is no right or wrong number here. Okay. Now, as far as applications, we do know that capacitors have several applications in electronics. Number one, they can act like a little battery, although some of the supercapacitors are acting a lot larger, like a larger battery, can hold a charge and release it. Number two, it's a way of blocking DC. You see, DC, when it charges the capacitor, that's it, game over. No more current's gonna flow, it's stopped. But with AC, it's a change in the voltage, the change just slips through the capacitor. So this is very common especially in analog circuits where I wanna have, you know, I have a DC voltage here, a DC voltage here, we connect a capacitor in between, and the changes, the AC gets to pass through. We also can use capacitors for timing. RC time constant, which I'm not going to ask you about. You know, I'm not going to have you do calculations. So it takes time for it to charge through a resistor. Potentiometer, I would hope you would know this by now, but a pot potentiometer. POT is the slang word. Or variable resistor allows us to adjust the resistance. This is a pretty good drawing of one. So you have the outside connectors. You have a wiper arm that slides between the two. And so if we're looking from this volt point to this point, the resistance varies. But if we put a voltage here and a voltage here, and we, you know, this is ground, this is say plus 12 volts, and I slide this up and down, you'll see that a linear pot has a linear relationship between its resistance. Okay, and of course we always think about the volume control of a radio. And that's very typical for potentiometers, but they do, I should say, they come in all sorts of shapes and sizes. All right, moving on. Now we get to the more important stuff. Resistors in parallel. Oops, that was supposed to highlight this guy. Okay, resistors in parallel. As you can see, one path, two paths, three paths. Well, the moment I hit two, that was it. There were multiple paths, more than one, for the current. So the big giveaway is that in a parallel circuit, there's more than one path for the current to take. Okay, now, let's assume in this drawing up here that this is a 12-volt battery. That being a 12-volt battery, the voltage across R1 is 12 volts. The voltage across R2, 12 volts. The voltage across R3, surprise, 12 volts. So finding the voltage across each one of these, fairly straightforward. Okay, now we know the voltage, finding the current across each resistor. It sounds difficult, but if I tell you the voltage, if I tell you the current, it's like going back to Ohm's law. Okay, so 12 volts divided by 100 ohms should give us 120 milliamp. 12 volts divided by 200 ohms, 60 milliamps. 12 volts divided by 300 ohms, 40 milliamps. I would hope you can do that calculation. Now, we could add up the current, then knowing the current, total current, because all these currents will add together in this circuit. If I know the voltage, if I know the total current, I could calculate the equivalent resistance. It is possible to do that, but that's kind of like the long way of doing it. The shortcut that we normally use, and I've broken it down into a series of steps. Step one used to be very important, but I'm finding that calculator manufacturers have been silently and quietly fixing the bug over the years. Used to be when you had, you know, 1 over 1.2k like that, you know, 1.2 enter exponent 3, it would come up with a squirrely answer. So nowadays, though, it seems to do it all right. But just to be on the safe side, you might convert your k's to actual whole numbers and the megs to whole numbers too. Step two, we want to take whatever the resistor values are and convert it to conductance. So one, down here, page 10, 1 divided by resistance gives us our conductance. You cannot add resistors in parallel. You could, but you get the wrong answer. We add them for series resistance. We can't do it for parallel. But what you can add is the conductance. So if I add this, 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 I get the answer in total conductance. Okay, now in this case, the G does not mean giga. It's referring to a unit of conductance. So step three, we add all the conductances together. Great, you've got the answer. Oh well, heck with it. But that's not the form I wanted it in. You have to convert conductance back to resistance. So step four, we have this equation. 1 divided by conductance will give us resistance. So here it is. 1 divided by the total conductance will give us our resistance. And you know, I put the dot, dot, dot to indicate on your calculator, this will go to a lot of places. Now, generally, and again, this won't be on the test because I will automatically do that, I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or more digits. That's ridiculous. We don't have that kind of accuracy. So I'm suggesting we round to three places. So let's take a look. 1 digit, 2 digit, 3 digits. Now, in this case, the 4 is less than 5, so we just simply erase it and only see the 54.5. Now, you can do it as a series of steps like that, but if you're like me, I like to do it the easy way. Okay, so again, step 1, I'll convert the k's and ohms, and I'll enter it as a single line on a calculator. Now, some calculators have a key that reads 1 over x. Other calculators have a key that reads x to the minus 1. So you'd enter the number, hit that key, whichever one you have, and remember, don't forget to put a left bracket, all this, close bracket, 1 over x or x to the minus 1 equals, and that should give you the answer. Now, here is the thing. Normally we could do a practice in class, but I did have practice with these values. Go ahead and try these calculations. See if your answer matches my answer. Okay, so let me go back to the top. Remember, and here's the tip, the answer is always less than the lowest value resistor. If you have an answer greater than the lowest value resistor, your answer is wrong. Now, I have a possible shortcut. If all, and the key word here is all the resistors are the exact same value, you can use a shortcut. Resistance divided by the number of resistors will give you the total. So in this case, we assume we have 5 100-ohm resistors in parallel. Well, 100 divided by 5 is 20. This is a heck of a lot easier than doing the long drawn-out formula. If you only have 2 resistors, it does this. If you have 4 resistors, you just keep adding on the terms as necessary. And again, I've already talked about practice this before the test. Page 11, now we go to page 12. Now we get into some of the really important meat. You cannot really have linear circuits without encountering this, and that is a voltage divider. Okay, there are 6 volts across these 2 resistors. Okay, what is the voltage from here to ground? So we're looking at R1. Okay, the higher resistor has the higher voltage, the lower resistor has the lower voltage. These 2 voltages must add up to our source voltage. Okay, so let's take a look. I could, of course, convert these to the regular ohms. We find the total resistance. Your calculator may not require that, but I'll mention it anyway. So we want to know the voltage across R1, which is usually the voltage I'm interested in. Occasionally I'm interested in this guy, but so what is R1's value? So 6 volts times, and again we go back up here, 5k ohms or 5,000 ohms, divided by the total, which happened to be this guy, 15,000 ohms, equals 2 volts. All right, what if I had asked you for the voltage across R2? Well, that's 10k ohms. Okay, so now instead of R1, we're putting the resistor I care about, R2. Supply voltage times R2 divided by our total. So 6 volts divided by 10,000 ohms divided by 15,000 ohms, the total resistance, gives us 4 volts. Okay, so here's a different problem. It's the same idea. 1k plus 2k, you know the total has to be 3k ohms. Okay, so I'm interested in R1 first. Again, it's the lower resistance. It's going to have the lower voltage. Lower resistance, lower voltage. Okay, so R1 in this case is the 1,000 ohms. 12 volts times 1,000 ohms divided by the total 3,000 ohms gives us 4 volts. If I had asked for R2, the lower resistor here, same basic idea, except now I'm putting in R2. 12 volts times 2,000 ohms divided by 3,000, 8 volts. Do practice this. Make sure you can get the correct answer before the test. We've discussed rounding numbers. I suppose I could have a problem like that on the test. Just remember, we count 1, 2, 3. It's the fourth digit I'm interested in. In this case, the fourth digit happens to be less than 5. 4 is less than 5. So we just drop it. All this part in the blue, we ignore, and it's 1, 2, 3. When it's 5 or greater, like 6, we have to increment the digit to the left of it. So 7 plus 1 is 8, it becomes 9.88. Okay. All right, that's about it. Reading a scope, this is going to be really hard for me to do on a test. But when we were doing rise time calculations, you notice I put the bottom of the waveform here, the top of the waveform there. This becomes the 10%, that becomes the 90% mark. Okay, now whenever I use a scope, okay, you always use a scope probe. Don't use the BNC to clip leads. That's a very rookie mistake, and if you do it at work, your boss will know you don't know what you're doing. Okay, now we have little tick marks and we have major divisions, both vertically and horizontally. We are counting the major divisions, and each tick mark counts up as 0.2. So for example, it doesn't say it here, but it's here, but let me just jump down to page 14. When we test a scope probe, we expect to see a nice square wave. It's rounded, the compensation is off. If it peaks, it's too high. This is reality. If you see this, some adjustment will be needed. Okay, so those tick marks. One tick, here we go. 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8. So say I have two divisions and it hits with single tick mark. 2.2. 2.4, 2.6, 2.8. What if it lands between tick marks, 0.4 and 0.6, right in between the two? What's the middle between 0.4 and 0.6? 0.5, of course. So that's how we measure the fractional amount. And remember, voltage per divisions times the number of lines or divisions gives us our voltage, and I prefer to measure it from the top of the bottom and the bottom of the waveform. That'll give us our voltage peak to peak. So in other words, if we lined it up here and we counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 3 tick marks, so it's 5.6 times whatever the scale for the voltage is, that would give us our voltage peak to peak. Okay, remember these formulas. Yes, I could ask these on a test. If you gave me the voltage peak to peak, this formula is, I may not be able to ask this on a test because here I'm saying, I'll tell you what, I will hold you to these formulas. I just can't go both directions. If I give you the voltage peak to peak, you divide it by 2 to get the voltage peak. Okay, so I can hold you to that. Knowing the voltage peak, you can divide it by 1.414 and get the voltage RMS. Very important to make a distinction between the two. It's like saying, what's the distance? 3. 3 inches? 3 feet? 3 yards? I have no idea. So you have to specify what type of voltage with AC. DC, it's easy. one number. So be sure to show context to any time you record that. So if I give it voltage peak or voltage peak to peak and say, what is the voltage RMS? Know how to calculate it. Now, some people have figured out, because you've studied math enough, couldn't I just take the voltage peak to peak and divide it by double this number, 2.828? And the answer is yes, that is another formula. If you understand, great, use it. If you don't, just stick to doing these two formulas and be sure to have them down in your notes. For measuring time, and remember the horizontal axis is the time, the vertical axis is voltage. So we're looking at what is the time per division times the number of divisions, including fractional amounts, and that is the time for the cycle, which we would more likely call period. Well, the period tells us how long the cycle is, but you have to take 1 divided by the period to get the frequency. Or if you had the frequency, 1 divided by frequency is the period. And of course, the biggest thing is people forget to take into account numbers like milliseconds or microseconds. So they see that the period is 2 microseconds. And they'll go 1 divided by 2, but not enter the microseconds, or take that into account. And they'll write 0.5, when really the answer should be 500 hertz. So be forewarned on that. Okay, I'm sorry this one took longer than the first. I try to keep them short. Let's just have a little bit of fun. I had a student about a year and a half ago. I joked about this in classroom. He went to the machine and he ordered a cheeseburger. Okay, no cheese, no mustard, no ketchup, no pickle, no onions, no meat, extra salt. Okay, so here's his actual receipt. 1 cheeseburger, no cheese, no mustard, no ketchup, no pickle, no onions, no regular meat, no bun, plain, extra salt. He paid $1 for this. He said, watching the people in back looking at the computer monitor going, what the heck do I do with this? Was worth the $1 for the laugh. And I used to have it, but somehow it disappeared out of my classroom. So, okay, so anyway, I don't think I have anything else to show you. So that pretty much wraps it up. Have a good day, and I will see you again. We get into, oh God, what chapter is that? Op Amps, Chapter 10, next. Come on.